Hello, my name is Haniel Maria, and I'm one of the internal medicine residents at Duke University Hospital. Today we will be talking about Neisseria gonorrhoeae infection. Our learning objectives for today are to understand the epidemiology of gonorrhoeae infection, to understand the basic pathophysiology of gonorrhoeae infection, to identify clinical features of gonorrhoeae, and to become familiar with diagnosis and basic treatment options for gonococcal infections. Starting off with epidemiology, there are about 700,000 new cases of gonorrhea reported in the United States each year. It is most common among teens, young adults, and African Americans. Regionally, gonorrhea infection is very prevalent in the Southeast United States, which makes it of particular concern here at Duke. To demonstrate, this map shows the number of gonorrhea infections reported per 100,000 people in each state. The red areas are the most prevalent areas, and as I mentioned, they are mostly in the Southeast United States. Our home, North Carolina, is actually fifth in the nation in terms of gonorrhea infections. And here's some data from the WHO concerning the global epidemiology of gonorrhea infection. Now, I do want to point out that these numbers are much older than those in the previous slide, as this data comes from 1999. Still, I think this slide highlights the point that gonorrhea is a very relevant infection globally. So you see, at that time, 92 million people were infected with gonorrhea, and every continent on the map is involved. Transmission of gonorrhea is generally through sexual contact. Vaginal sex is the most likely mode of transmission. There's a reported 50 to 93% risk of transmission if having unprotected vaginal sex with an infected partner. Anal sex is also a common source of transmission, particularly in the population of men having sex with men. Oral sex is a mode of transmission for oropharyngeal gonorrhea. Interestingly, I also came across this piece of data at the bottom of the slide, that gonorrhea infection increases the risk of transmitting HIV for those who already have HIV. To put it another way, if an individual has HIV and then becomes infected with gonorrhea, it's been shown that there is an 8-time increase in the amount of HIV RNA present in the urethra of that individual. This increases the likelihood of transmission of HIV during sexual contact. So this is an image of Neisseria gonorrhoeae. As you can see, it's a gram-negative diplococcus. The arrow in the center here points to the pili, which are on the external surface of the bacteria. These assist in the pathophysiology, which we will cover in the next slide. Pathophysiology of gonorrhea infection has four main stages. The first of these stages is attachment to the mucosal surface. This is mediated by the pili, which we saw on that previous slide. The pili attach directly to the columnar epithelium of the host mucosal surface. The next step is invasion. The bacteria itself initiates a process called parasite-directed endocytosis. This allows the gonorrhea access to the interior of the mucosal cells. Once inside the cells, the third stage of infection, intracellular replication, can occur. Following intracellular replication, there is an inflammatory response, which involves the complement cascade, TNF-alpha, and subsequently a neutrophilic infiltration, which creates the purulent discharge, which is characteristic of clinical gonorrhea infection. In some individuals, there also occurs a disseminated form of gonococcal infection, which we will discuss later in this talk. Clinical features, starting with females, and then we'll also discuss males. Approximately 50% of females are asymptomatic when infected with gonorrhea. Of those who do have symptoms, cervicitis is the most common type of infection. This is characterized by vaginal discharge, itching, and may also cause painful intercourse. On pelvic exam, you may notice a friable cervix. In about 10 to 40% of cases of cervicitis, the infection can ascend further into the reproductive tract, causing pelvic inflammatory disease. This is characterized by pelvic and abdominal pain, potentially vaginal bleeding, and also fever. Uterine or adnexal tenderness may be present on your physical exam. Oropharyngeal infections can occur and are characterized by purulent discharge, erythema, and sore throat. And finally, in females who participate in receptive anal sex, anorectal infection or proctitis can also occur. Switching over to males, similar to females, there is an asymptomatic population, though in males it's estimated to be only about 10%. Among those who do have symptoms, urethritis, which is similar to cervicitis, is the most common manifestation. It's characterized by purulent discharge and itching, as well as potentially dysuria. Epididymitis can occur and manifests with testicular pain and tenderness. This may be unilateral or bilateral, but more often is unilateral. In men having sex with men, prostatitis, anorectal infection, or proctitis can occur. In prostatitis, you may find a tender prostate on your physical exam. In anorectal infection or proctitis, clinical signs include anorectal discharge and perianal or perirectal pain. These are two images showing the most likely clinical manifestation of gonorrhea infection. On the left is cervicitis. You see the cervix with an erythematous inflammatory reaction as well as white purulent discharge. On the right is an image of the penis, also with purulent discharge and prominent erythema around the urethral meatus. As I mentioned earlier, there are instances in which disseminated gonococcal infection can occur. This can occur due to traits of the gonorrhea bacteria itself or characteristics of the host. It's been shown that some strains of gonorrhea bacteria are able to evade the host complement and humoral immunity responses, allowing these strains to disseminate throughout the body. The mechanisms behind this resistance are not yet completely clear and are currently a topic of research. Among host characteristics, complement deficiency, particularly C5 to C9, or the MAC complex, is a source of disseminated gonococcal infection. Females who are menstruating are also more susceptible to dissemination. Females who are pregnant or immediately postpartum are susceptible given relative immune suppression. And finally, individuals affected with lupus are susceptible due to alterations in their complement response. Clinically, disseminated gonococcal infection is significantly different than typical gonorrhea infections. Genitourinary symptoms are actually uncommon in disseminated infection. Instead, the most likely symptoms are those which are typical of bacteremia. So think of things like fevers and rigors. In disseminated gonococcal infection, these symptoms tend to occur about 60% of the time. Arthralgias are also relatively common. They can occur in one joint or in multiple joints, though they tend to affect the joints of the extremities while sparing the axial skeleton. You should also note that the affected joints may not have a septic appearance on your exam, and this does not exclude the presence of infection within the joint. Tenosynovitis is also reported in about 2/3 of patients with disseminated infection. Finally, nonspecific skin lesions are frequently present. These can manifest in almost any type of skin rash or lesion, including macules, papules, hemorrhagic lesions, bullae, etc. We'll move on now to diagnosis of gonorrhea infections. The primary gonococcal tests are for localized mucosal infection and include cervical or urethral swab of the purulent discharge. This is followed by a Gram stain or a diagnostic culture demonstrating gonorrhea bacteria. In some clinics and hospitals, there is also a urine DNA amplification test, and we do have this available at Duke. For individuals who have disseminated gonococcal infection, blood culture is the gold standard for diagnosis. A synovial joint aspirate may also be useful, and I've listed the criteria for diagnosis here. However, as I mentioned before, many with disseminated infection do not have a drainable joint effusion. Skin biopsy tends to be non-diagnostic. As we discussed earlier, skin manifestations tend to be non-specific, and similarly, biopsy results are also non-specific. Finally, as an aside, remember always to test for other sexually transmitted diseases and to test sexual partners when a diagnosis of gonorrhea is made. Finally, how do we treat gonococcal infection? The mainstay of treatment for localized infection is one intramuscular dose of ceftriaxone. It should also be noted that gonorrhea infection is often accompanied by a chlamydia co-infection. Because of this, you should also treat for chlamydia infection with either azithromycin or doxycycline. For disseminated gonococcal infection, treatment is still with ceftriaxone, and you should also cover for chlamydia. However, the dose of ceftriaxone is increased and the duration of treatment is extended until 1 or 2 days after symptomatic improvement, and then this is followed by a 1 week course of oral cefixime. Symptomatic management of joint effusions by drainage and pain management with NSAIDs may also be of use. To summarize, gonorrhea is a sexually transmitted infection of both males and females. It is caused by a gram-negative diplococcus, which can invade virtually any mucosal surface. This leads to clinical features including discharge and inflammation of the affected mucosal surface. Infection may disseminate systemically in minority of cases. Diagnosis is by culture of mucosal discharge or by urine DNA testing. For disseminated infection, blood cultures are the diagnostic test of choice. Primary treatment is ceftriaxone, and you should also treat for chlamydia co-infection. And here are a list of my references. And some acknowledgments. Thank you to Dr. Amy Zoss for helping me with the preparation of this presentation. As well, I'd like to thank Dr. Gallagher and Dr. Bergen, who supervised me and guided me in caring for a patient with disseminated gonococcal infection who was admitted to Duke Hospital. Thank you all very much for listening.